Alright guys, what's going on? It's Jason Soehiller here, and I got an awesome guest.
You may know him as Cousin Oliver from the Brady Bunch, but also he just did 5 years on Disney Junior's hit show Doc McStuffins. He has also been in the animated films Balto. He also is a Ninja Turtle. He is a Gecko. He is a Dogen Doggies. He's been busy.
Well, it's Robbie Rist over here, and I'm totally honored. Obviously, I'm a little stargassed right now as I just...
For God's sake, you're going to be... By the time this is over, you're going to be like, good Lord, I can't wait for this to be over. You only feel that way now.
So... before we go in, so we're going to probably talk mainly about Ninja Turtles because that's what most of the audience here is for.
Bring it on.
But before we actually go in that, I know you are actually hosting a podcast called The Spoon. And
yes.
So you want to go ahead and go explain what that podcast is about?
It's not about anything. We describe it as playing with a cat with a laser pointer. We sort of get halfway into a subject, and then someone else's ADD kicks in, and then we're on to another topic, and then we're on to another topic. We hope it's comedic talk.
That's pretty cool.
Under ideal circumstances, under the best shows, it's comedic talk.
Gotcha. Actually, that's the kind of stuff I like to listen to while I'm driving.
It
distracts me from the boringness that I am driving.
Yeah. I totally get that. Yeah, it's a really weird world that we've entered into now, where the exact kind of entertainment you want, you can have always.
Right.
So if you're in the car and you're like, I cannot listen to another Ariana Grande song or what have you. I don't know if you do or not, but let's say for this argument, you do.
For this argument, I do because of my wife.
There you go. So definitely then I can see you going, hey, honey, how about we turn off the Ariana Grande, all right? And then on goes that. So it is interesting to me that, like, you know, I listen to a lot of interview podcasts and things like that. It's, you know, it's the Wild West that you are, that you're sort of the tip of the spear of.
Right. That's pretty cool. So, what other current projects are you doing currently?
Well, I'm writing a comic book. Right now Doc McStuffins just ended, so I'm taking a little time off to do some just sort of other kind of creative projects. So there was a child actor in the 70s named Mason Reese. If you look him up, he was massive for about 8 years. Really, really crazy. So Mason and I have written a screenplay, so we're trying to sell that, and I'm producing a punk rock guitar player from the 70s. I'm working on, I wrote songs for all the Sharknado movies.
Oh, that's so pretty cool.
Yeah, so now the director of the Sharknado movies is doing a zombie film, so I'm doing a couple of songs for that. And I do stuff. Somebody told me a long time ago, if you're going to be in the entertainment business, don't specialize.
Right.
So yeah. So and I've started sort of entering con world as well. I'm going to be at Vision Con at some point. And when is that? May?
May 10th to the 12th, actually.
Yeah. That's when that is. Yeah.
It's the only reason I know. Only reason I know that because it's 2 days before my birthday.
Oh, right on. Well, happy birthday to you, sir.
Thank you. Excellent. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
So, what actually got you into voice acting?
Well, I've been doing on camera I've been doing on camera since I was 7. And I was at an agency that had a young people's department, and they had a young people's department, print, commercial, and voiceover. Those are their four kind of specialties. Oh. And so the voiceover department, whenever they needed a young, you know, voice for something, they would dip into the kids department. And it turned out that I started picking up more and more of these jobs. And I found myself going, wait a minute, are you telling me that a cartoon, we can record the whole thing in 4 hours, leaving the rest of the day for me to misbehave in whatever fashion I choose? And so I just went voiceover. This is for me. I mean, it's over quickly. I can do Yeah, I that 80s D thing that I was talking about. I mean, it's a joke, but I mean, right. I definitely operate better when I'm not doing the same thing all of the time. So, you know, every voiceover job is different, and it was, then it became solely my living for like 25 years. I decided just because of art reasons, I'm going to start trying to do on-camera stuff again, but primarily it's been voiceover.
That's pretty cool, and I know that you have your own voiceover studio.
I have a studio school. I teach voiceover. I make people's demos. I consult. I help. Are you ready for this? This is something, it could probably help you. What is the name of your show? I'm sorry, I forgot.
Moving Lakposht Studio.
Ah, okay. So moving.
Lakposht. Lakposht is the Farsi word for turtle.
Ah, that's pretty great.
My wife and I were Iranian, and so we're like trying to, because my wife's actually an animator.
Really?
She was like trying to decide what to do for the name, and I was like, I like turtle, let's just call it Lakposht, and then we found out like later, like, hey, not a lot of people can find that.
Oh, yeah, well, that's their problem, not yours.
Exactly.
You know what? I have an idea. Why don't you try expanding your horizons, you small-minded douche monkey? But, you know, that's just how I look at it. That's just me. But, yeah, there you go. Your issue with people pronouncing your name. Maybe we could, you know, we could find a way to, in upended commas, brand it better.
That's right.
But yeah, so that's kind of what, it's called 10,000 hours. And it's basically what, that's another one of, somebody said, don't specialize. All right, then I'm going to teach also. and I've, you know, my demos have gotten people work. You know, they've gotten agents from it. So, you know, I know what I keep working. They haven't kicked me out of entertainment yet, so apparently I know what I'm doing.
That's always a good thing.
Yeah.
Actually, I've told countless people that if, because currently my day job is a computer programmer, but if I could do anything else, it would definitely be voice acting, because that's something I've always wanted to do.
Wait. What is stopping you? You know, you can, first off, your wife is an animator! Do your own damn cartoon.
We actually are I do because my wife, she actually has been doing these Ninja Turtles shorts. We call it Teenage Mutant Nonsense Turtles, and we just have them just do comedy things instead of like actual action things, and I do the voice of like all four turtles.
But wait a minute, why don't you take that very idea and just make your own idea around that, and then do a whole crap ton of voices for it. And then, look, you're already doing this internet thing. Already on YouTube doing stuff. Why can't you have a second channel for all your animation stuff? The Angry Video Game Nerd has, like, four channels.
That is true. Actually, I did like the fact that you were the alien in the movie.
Totally. A bunch of years ago, James did a review of Turtles 3.
Yes.
That was easily one of the funniest things I've ever seen. I watched it so many times. It was mostly because of him. He's hilarious. So I sent him a message going, look, if you're ever doing anything, you know, and you need me for it, put me in, coach. I want to play. And so he called me to do this alien part, and I'm like, this is so great. I get to be the alien guy. You know, and then I got to work with him, and he's a really cool guy. And, you know, he's another one of these people, though, that is like you. You know, he's got this, you know, and I'm sure you have something of a following, you know, I don't know. I mean, the spoon has had, I think, the same 200 or 300 people since Eisenhower. So, but the thing is, you have a bit of a following, and you can build on that. Look what James Rolfe did.
Thanks. Yeah. I really appreciate it. You know, let's get the focus.
By the way, you're now having a spoon episode. Now you know what happens. Yeah.
I'm really enjoying it. Trust me. But you know what? Let's get into Ninja Turtles. So at least the people who like clicked off this video can click back on.
Yeah, they're like, oh, good lord, people, shut up.
So, you know, let's travel back to like 1989, 88, whenever you got the script. You got a script that's called Teenage.
Oh, no, it was 91.
It was 91.
It was late 90, probably because.
I thought it was 91. You know, I'm not right off the top of my head. Sorry, Ninja Turtle people.
You're probably right. I'm not. I never argue with fans. No. The fans are the people that put that damn thing there. They know their stuff. That's what makes them fans. You know. So all right. So I guess 89.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
So what had happened was two years before. Yeah, two or three years before, I was in this band with some guys from St. Louis. And one of the guys in the band, you know, he was in his 30s, but he was a really big comic book nut. And I was, you know, I was at his house one day, and he threw this thin little black and white comic, and it wasn't, you know, full size. It was like smaller, you know, and he says, this is just hilarious. This is expletive deleted hilarious. And threw it at me. And I looked at it and I was like, well, it's kind of dark and grim. But yeah, what a goofy idea, blah, blah, blah. I didn't watch the cartoon. I had no idea that was happening. And then they sent me the audition for it. Uh-huh. And I was like, they're making a cartoon? Were they making a movie for kids out of the thing that I read? I'm like, it's going to be a hard PG-13,
right,
if not an R, you know? And you know, they were looking for a surf guy, and I'm from the San Fernando Valley, which is basically the birth of surf speak. So I went to high school with at least 10 or 15 guys that all talk that way, and about the rest of the girls. So I kind of had that in my back pocket because, you know, I of course, being who I am, I was always making fun of them. So I did the audition as the surf guy, and, you know, I got it, and I was like, oh, this is interesting. And then we go in to record, like, you know, the movie's all done when they call us in. You know, right. Basically, the whole thing's cut together. So I'm in the studio doing, you know, ADRing my stuff, and I overhear, like, someone from production. Well, you know, someone's kind of up out of the art part and into the, you know, the office part, talking to the guy who was running the voiceover session, going, we're getting word back from New World Pictures, right? That was who put it out.
New Line Cinema.
Golden Harvest New Line, right?
Golden Harvest New Line Cinema.
Yeah, New Line. And he said, the New Line people are like, this thing might be too dark for kids. We might be taking a huge bath on this thing. And I'm half-assed listening at work, but I'm like, oh, that's kind of interesting. And then that happened. Then it comes out, and right. It is like, yeah. The weird thing about that movie is, you know, aside from the fact that it made almost $200 million in its initial run, that was all on kids' tickets,
right?
Which are half price. So if you went by adult tickets, it made half a billion. You know, it would have made $500 million. You know,
right.
Just,
right.
But even in that, there were kids that were seeing it five and six times.
I can tell you, I saw that movie at least three times in theaters when I was like.
How old were you when you first saw it?
I was 10, I believe.
Golden age. That's the between. It's like between 8 and 12. They just get you.
Right. Right. Exactly. Because I remember there was a point like where my mom was like, "No, we're not going to see this movie again." Like she was like, "No, we're going to wait for it to come on video." And like my mom, my parents like never bought movies on video because they were like, "Oh no, it's way too much money. We only watch it once." They had to buy that one on video because of me.
So you are in 1990. You were 10, or yes, did you see it?
Uh-huh. Yes. In 1990, I was 10.
Okay. You look great for your age.
Thank you. I really appreciate that.
No problem, yeah.
Trust you're hats off my age shows.
You're like a total old dude. I mean, geez, you know. So you're 10 and you see the thing, and next thing you're beating up all the furniture in the house.
Exactly. Right. Actually, I've always like told a story to like everyone whenever I host panels and conventions. Ninja Turtles is what taught me how to cuss, because I lived in this like sheltered life, like where my parents like never, like, I mean, first, like, my parents, like, English was like their second language, and it was my second language as well. So like we never used like curse words and that kind of stuff. And then all of a sudden I see the Ninja Turtles movie, and Raphael has that scene where he's like on the rooftop and he shouts, "Damn!" And I just remember after the first time I went to go see that movie, after I came back from my house, like came back to the house, and my mom was asked me to clean my room, and I shouted that, and like my mom was like really mad, and she didn't even tell me like why I can't say that word. I was just like, it was a brand new word.
It couldn't be that bad. You're still alive.
Exactly. It can't be that bad.
Because I have immigrant parents too. So, and they're both small town Germans. So super like, yeah, really like sort of conservative viewpoint on everything. And as a kid, you know, isn't it? I don't know. I'm sorry. We're spooning again. But as a young kid of immigrant parents, did you, like, I would go over to my, like my friends whose parents were from America. Right. And I always felt like, it's so weird in here.
Yes.
It's weird. Yes. It's not good or bad. It's neither. It's right. Just, it's weird.
Right. That's how I was like. To me, it was always like something weird. Like you know, like our house, we had like so many like just like things from Iran, just all over, like all a culture and everything. And then I go to like other people's houses. They have like pictures of themselves. And I'm like...
Yeah, totally. At which point I told my mom, why can't we be like an American family? And she went, well, if we were an American family, I guess you'd be in your room right now. And I went, all right, I get it. Okay, I guess we're... Subject's not open to discussion, I see. Okay.
Trust me, that was the same thing growing up in my house as well.
Yeah. Exactly. It's like, oh, really? Oh, we're not talking about that. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
See you later. Yeah. So anyway, okay, so you're... I have heard so many... Like, oh, okay. I've been doing this for a long time.
Yeah.
And so the different things that I've done... Different people have gravitated toward. They become admirers of the thing.
Right.
And so, but the one thing that seems to always happen is, and I don't know if this is true with every voiceover person that has to do with the turtles or anything else, but very frequently when people come up to talk to me, they want to tell me their story of the association with the thing.
Right.
Okay? And some of the stories I have heard are... They take it up and out of it just being a movie about a bunch of guys in rubber suits beating up other guys in rubber suits.
Right.
It somehow has a deeper meaning to, and my example is, there's a woman out there who is arguably the biggest turtle fan on the planet. Her name is Michelle Ivy. Do you know who she is?
She's the one with the big collection, right?
Right, and she has a thing called Cowabunga Corner,
yes.
And she's really amazing. So when we met, she goes, you know, I want to tell you my story, you know, we got into it, I'm excited to do the thing, you know, fun movie. Apparently, as a kid, she was really bullied a lot, and she went to go see the movie, and she walked out and said, you know, if they can defend themselves, why can't I? And she became a black belt in karate because of it.
Oh, that's now, really cool.
It's amazing. It's a really amazing story. And it, I don't know, it shows the power of art. It shows how the simplest thing that you think would just be a trifle actually can garner some huge amount of meaning for someone. And I think that's an amazing thing to be a part of. You know, yeah. It's just a, it's a really strange you know, my world is very strange because of that.
Right.
In a good way, but right. It's strange.
Right. Right, exactly. Now, something I will say about, like, you know, the original trilogy, you are the only constant.
Yeah, all the good ones end in O.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah, because, like, because everyone else, like, either they left and then, or they came back, or, like, they got picked up on another one. You're the only, mm-hmm. I think you're the only person, like actual, like.
Yeah, you know, it's what happens when you're dependable.
You're right.
it's what happens when you show up for work every time. I don't know. I couldn't be happier about that either, you know. I mean, it's an amazing thing that, you know, I mean, even at this point, I don't make a whole lot in the way of money from it, you know, but I have so many new experiences all of the time because of people and that movie.
Right, which is actually pretty cool. So, yeah. I'm pretty sure, like, you know, people, like, you know, you've heard, like, a bunch of your lines, like, quoted all the time. Like,
yeah.
What is actually one of your favorite lines? Like,
oh, well, that's easy. No, you see, in the third movie, the, you know, the one everyone hates.
Exactly, that one?
Yeah, the third movie that everyone hates. They gave me a lot of leeway to write my own dialogue. And they actually gave Corey an opportunity for him to write a lot of dialogue as well. And mine are funnier. That's all I'm going to say. But my favorite line is from that one, which is a guy comes up and he takes a katana sword and he hits he hits Michelangelo on the shell. Yeah. And Michelangelo stops and goes, "He who dings the shell must pay."
Mikey, watch out! Ah! Oh, he who dings the shell must pay.
You know, I completely forgot about that line.
Yeah, and that one's mine, you know, because it's vaguely threatening. And you know.
That's actually pretty cool. Actually, so speaking of, like, dialogue, we've talked to the puppeteers before, and something that they told us, like, what happens is that, like, they will, when they do the puppeteering, and then they do the scratch work for the voice, so they kind of, like,
do their own lines.
Did that limit you? Like, or did you have to, like, do their lines, or were you able to kind of put your own?
Well, it was challenging because the puppeteers didn't go to school with surfers like I did.
Right.
So the characters that they were doing were not necessarily the characters that they hired. So I had to kind of work around, was it Michelin, who was in the suit?
Yes, it was Michelin. He's actually a really
Michelin Sisti. Oh no, I've met him. He's a really sweet guy. Nick Palma too.
Yeah,
those super cool guys. But so his delivery is a little bit more. It's a little faster. Mm-hmm. It's a little. It's slightly. I don't know if he's from New York, but it has that kind of a clip to it. So I had to kind of find ways to slow it down without slowing it down.
Right.
You know? I mean, you know, anybody who says that voiceover is easy, anybody who says acting is easy, really needs to be taken out back and just smacked around with like a piece of raw meat or something, because it's such a strange set of skills that you need to do the job. Right. And especially in voiceover, because voiceover is one of the things I teach is that acting is playing cowboys and Indians for grown-ups. It's playing cowboys and Indians for money. Mm-hmm. And so when we were kids, all of our pretend play that we did. I usually use the appliance box analogy. Like, somebody in the neighborhood got an appliance box, and that ended up on the front yard while the parents were hooking the thing up.
Right.
And in that time, that box was a castle or a spaceship, or it was any, you know, and the kids would just turn it into their own toy. That's one of the things I say all the time. You can give a child an empty box and he can entertain himself. And here's why. Because when we were in that box pretending it was a rocket ship or a castle or whatever, we no longer, in our imaginations, saw the box. We saw the dials of the spaceship. We saw the window outside. We saw the planet that we were circling, that we were going to land on soon. All in our mind, completely vivid, as if it were a very real thing. And then when we got to be 8-year-olds, our parents started going, well, you can't just daydream all the time. And so they started telling us not to do this thing. Well, as an adult, that's what acting is. But to do it well, you have to have that same childlike imagination where you are not in your house with a microphone. You are on planet Zendar and you're about to fight the Gremulark.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? Yes. And the thing is, it is as real as real could be. In those Lord of the Rings movies, Benedict Cumberbatch plays this dragon character.
Right,
Smog. Are you what?
Smog.
Right, okay. I knew you'd know that. So, I don't know if you have seen the raw footage of him in the motion capture suit.
No, I haven't, actually.
It's on YouTube, and I highly suggest anybody who likes voiceover and acting and anything having to do with art should watch that. Because you watch that movie, and what they do is they have the screen, you know, they have the movie scene right next to him in the same screen, right?
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And to see how uncomfortable he is doing that scene, and then watching the video of how it turned out, it shows you everything that most people should be frightened away of doing acting. Because he is in that room. You can see it in his face. But really what he's doing is he's laying on a gray painted floor.
Uh-huh.
You know, so, yeah, I don't know how I got in this thing. I spooned again. I'm sorry.
You're fine. No, it's actually really cool.
But yeah, that's the thing about the special set of skills that are needed to be an actor. In this particular case, no, it's really distracting to have headphones on and you're watching a screen and there's 4 beeps and you then say the line. But as you go in to say the line, somebody in your ear is saying the exact same line the wrong way.
Oh, gosh.
And so you have to just work around them and just make sure the lip flaps are there. You've got the thing and the whatever. But yeah, it's a really weird, what I've learned in doing this since I was 6 is that it's a really weird job and it never stops being that.
Right. Yeah. Every time I talk, because I've talked to the stunt people, I've talked to voice people, I've talked to the puppeteer. It's like so interesting, like how like the 3 or 4 people that it takes to make one character and like.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
I mean, if you look at, it's not even done like that anymore now. Well, now you have Michael Bay sodomizing it, but I'm sorry. I didn't mean that. Wait, no, yes, I do. aliens. What's wrong with you? It's like, I don't care if you're a fan. I'm going to slap you in the face. I don't care who put the franchise where it is. I just want your money.
Exactly.
So, now I spooned again. Why was I going down the thing of making these movies? Oh, that's that technology that made, you know, I mean, there's all kinds of old, you know, the shark from Jaws and all of this stuff. It was using a lot of old technology, kind of updated a little bit because it was still pulleys for a lot of it. And, you know, the heads, like by the 3rd movie, I think the heads are a remote controlled.
Right.
But I think in the 1st one, they're still wearing wires or something. It's crazy. I think it was Michael, maybe Michelin, who told me that when they were doing the movies, they had two suits. They had the before lunch suit and the after lunch suit. And one of them was always wet. They were always drying. one of the suits of all four guys. Yeah, because they were losing like 10 pounds of water. In North Carolina, under the lights. Just ridiculous. Who wants to do that? That's another thing. And that's another thing in acting. There's a whole bunch of people that would never, they would do one day of work in that suit, and they'd go, this is not for me.
Right. Right. Yeah. I do know, some of the stunt actors, they didn't come back because of that.
And then on the, money does just wrecks everything. Yeah. One of the guys on the second movie asked for $500 more a week for suit work, and they just fired him.
Oh, wow.
I'm just like, really?
Really?
Yeah. Wow. It's amazing. Yeah. So, because you just made $200 million! What are you doing?
Exactly. They could have shelled it out.
Anyhow. Continue, sir.
Exactly. So, I also know you did a recurring character in The Adventures of Puss in Boots.
Yeah.
Go ahead, get it. Go ahead, get after it now. Get it. All right, now. Hey, dude, bro, give me a sec. Just blasting my pecs.
Which is actually all the guys, all the brothers are all turtles.
Yes. Now,
it's an actual dad.
That's something I really want to know. Oh, because it's three of the four brothers. It's you, Mikey Kelly, and Greg Sipes.
Right.
You three voice Michelangelo.
Yeah.
Coincidence or it was intense?
No, they did it on purpose.
They did it on purpose. That's actually really cool. It was something because obviously they're ninjas. They have the headbands and everything. And I was like, this can't be a coincidence. They had to have done. So that's actually really cool.
Yeah, it's hilarious. It's a great gag. And who is that joke for? I mean, seriously. Yeah. I mean, the person watching it, who's going to put together that there's three Michelangelos doing the thing? It's such an inside baseball joke.
Right.
It impresses me.
Right. Exactly. Because I just remember when I first watched it, I was like, wait a minute here. So that was actually really cool. And then, of course, they brought you back in the 2012 series as Mondo Gecko.
Ugh, dude, that name sucks, and I'll make you pay for it.
That. I'm pretty sure that was also intentional as well, right?
Yeah, it was. Yeah. The producer, I only see him twice a year. Anyway, now I'm fired. He said it was an intentional thing to get, to get me back in there.
That, so something with Mondo Gecko though, I felt that you kind of sounded more like Townsend Coleman than you did yourself.
Oh, that's funny. I don't know. That none of that is conscious if it's happening. Yeah. I just kind of went, I didn't go full Michelangelo with it just because, some of it's going to sound like that anyway because it's me. But I didn't want to go full Michelangelo on it because, well, kind of already did that.
Right. You know what I mean? Right. And that's something actually, because Corey also came back as a character too, and I was actually really happy that both you guys weren't trying to do you guys again.
And it
really actually showed off your guys' vocal skills and everything. And I do like that your character introduced Cowabunga into the series.
Yeah, that Booyakasha thing. Really? I don't know. Maybe I'm just a purist. I don't know.
They just want to be their own thing.
Well, it happens with, I have a friend who's the voice of Porky Pig, Bob Bergen.
Yes.
And Bob and I went to high school together. We've known each other a very long time. And he's been Porky Pig since the 80s.
Oh, wow.
But that does not stop some 28-year-old cartoon producer who wants to, in upended commas, put his stamp on it, that he doesn't want to audition a whole bunch of new Porky Pigs just to see if he can find the new discovery. And of course, Bob always gets it.
Right.
But it's look, man, just nobody did that to Dawes Butler. You know what I mean? It's either Paul Frees was going to be working or he wasn't. It wasn't should we have him audition? What are you kidding me? He's been Porky Pig since the 80s. He knows things about the character that you haven't even dreamed up yet. sometimes the entertainment business makes me want to scream.
There's nothing wrong with that. Just absolutely nothing. conventions, because I know you have one that's coming up and everything. Like, how much do you like it? Like, when you get to meet the fans, like in that, like where they come to you.
It's amazing to me that I keep getting lucky enough to work on these things that actually touch people in a very profound way, and it's always good energy coming at me. You know, very few people are like, yeah, I saw the movie. I thought you sucked. that almost never happens. And like I said, always good stories, always, you know, Turtle fans are really cool. I can't believe Michael Bay was going to dick them around like that.
Right. Exactly. I'm still amazed that you actually knew what the turtles were before he actually.
I was aware of it. Yeah, but also I kind of have always kind of kept my ear to the ground on popular culture things. Oh. So I like to know about indie directors and people that haven't done it yet. Usually, if somebody gets super successful, at that moment I go, well, you don't need me anymore. anytime one of bad, any band that I saw in clubs, all of a sudden goes on a major tour and makes billions of dollars, I'm like, all right, have a good journey. You I've done my work. Have a good one. And I feel that way about, where'd I go? We may have to edit that out. I lost my train of thought. Every once in a while that happens. I'm 55 now. So nothing. I don't know where my car keys are. I don't even know who I'm married to anymore. I'm like, I see this cute blonde walking around. I'm like, somebody should snap her up. And then she's like, we're married. What? Oh. Well, I made a good call, didn't I?
Oh, so Robbie, this has been...
I'm sorry.
Oh, no, you're great.
We spooned the hell out of this thing. Just like, what did you guys talk about, turtles? Yeah, maybe for about 40, 50 seconds.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe about 5 minutes.
Well, that just means I have to come back.
Exactly. Oh, no. I would love for you to come back.
Anytime. Anytime. You should be on my show, too.
I would love to be on your show.
Yeah. All right.
We're good places for, fans to interact with you.
All right. Let's see. I'm all over social media stuff. If you just do a search, you'll find me. I got a couple of Facebook pages. I got an Instagram page. I'm just about to put up a website that sort of, coalesces all of the various things I do. So there's some production stuff on there, and there's, I produced a little commerce department, so I made a movie in 2006 that's up there. Every band I've ever produced, they have their links up there. So that's going up, and I got a Patreon site that's going up. Just find me, and then we could talk about it later. My entire life is a work in progress. Nothing will ever be finished.
I understand. If you guys are watching this, if you guys are in the Springfield, Missouri area in May, be sure to come check them out at VisionCon. hopefully, I don't think I'll be able to make it that one, because unfortunately I have another convention during that same time period.
I guess we can forget about that goddamn spoon showing then.
Oh, man.
Yeah, no, you were going to be on. You were that close. You had one thing to do.
You know what? Maybe I'll cancel some things.
Maybe you'll cancel some things. That's what I'm thinking.
Oh, my God. This was such a pleasure.
It was delightful.
The fact I'm talking to Michelangelo, I'm still trying to process this. But thank you so much for coming.
And, oh yeah.
I honestly can't wait to see actually see you in person. And
I'm still
gonna take you up on that spoon offer.
No, you will. I'll have you on. It'll be great.
All right. Thanks for watching, guys. All right. Till next time, guys. All right. See ya.
All right. serious. Can I swear on your show?
Sure, why not?
Okay, well, I can now.
Yeah.